And that screen will go live and it'll be... Well, good morning, everyone, and welcome to Bethel this morning. Good to have you here with us, those in the room. Lovely to have Sydney Elliott with us. It's great to have you back again, Sydney. Thank you so much for coming from Grace. And Grace are meeting in the afternoons now at the moment, aren't they, down at Bridge Chapel. So please pray for Sydney. He's got this and then goes to Grace this afternoon. And so we pray for them today. And hopefully in a few weeks' time, we'll be more or less back to normal. And we'll be meeting at regular times and things like that. But we'll wait and see and keep praying about that as well. So it's lovely to have you here this morning, Sydney. Welcome to those who are at home as well, watching, whether it's live or in the week. It's lovely to have you joining with us here at Bethel. Just want to mention a few things before I hand over to Sydney. You remember, those of us who've been here for a little while, Sydney was the pastor here up to about 20 years ago. I think that was right. Roundabout, somewhere around that region anyway, so some of us older ones will remember that. Sydney's eldest son, Daniel, is being inducted next week as the pastor of Crowded House Church in Sheffield. So that makes me feel really old, okay? Because I remember Daniel coming to ours as a little boy and helping Paul tidy up the room before he went home. So he's always had a servant heart, that lad. So we wish him well and we pray for him next week as he starts that new chapter in his life. So pray for them next week as a family. You'll see in the newsletter there's a number of folk we need to pray for. Just mentioned Graham. He's still in hospital. He thought he might be in and out within a couple of days, but he's going to be in quite a bit longer. No doubt he's missing his dogs, so he's probably feeling a little bit down at the moment. So he's in Ward 2. If you'd like to send him a card to cheer him up, then by all means send one to Brogreen Hospital, Ward 2. And cheer him up with that. Please continue to pray for Maureen. It's good to see Jim here this morning. And please pray for them as a family as well. Tonight we've got Peter Lawrence with us, and he'll be bringing God's word to us. And then, as we say always on Wednesday, please join with us over Zoom. It's been a great blessing to be able to do that over the last number of months, and it's really lovely to be able to pray together and then just chat together as well, and to meet around God's word and hear what God has to say through his word. So please join with us if you haven't done that already. Can I encourage you to do that? Can I also encourage you, a few people over the last couple of weeks have taken advantage of the fact that we can now meet in homes and that we can meet outside. And we were hoping, obviously, last Monday that all the regulations would change and we'd be able to do things as a church together. And obviously that hasn't taken place and that's been delayed. But maybe over the next few weeks until July, whenever it changes, maybe you can use your open space, maybe your garden or backyard or wherever it is, your local park, just to meet up with people, encourage people to meet together and have some fellowship together. I know some have already done that and it's great that they've done that. It doesn't have to be anything fancy, a tea and a biscuit or a flask and a chair in Bankfield Park or wherever it may be. And just take advantage of that to do that and meet together with other folk. And what we've been missing is that fellowship together, isn't it? So I encourage you to do that. That would be good. And then hopefully as things open up in July, we'll organise a couple of events either here at Bethel or elsewhere where we can all meet together and we can make the best advantage of that. So please keep that in mind. I can also encourage you to come this evening. There's plenty of space for this evening. So if you haven't put your name down already, then please just send a message to Phil, admin@bethelliverpool.co.uk, and you can be added onto the list for this evening. If you don't get a chance to do that, then probably just best you can turn up and we can add your name on when you arrive. So that would be great to have you here with us this evening. So it's good to be together and to be able to worship God together. And we're going to do that now. I'm going to ask Sydney to come up and lead us and take us through our service this morning. Thank you.
Good morning. Thank you for your welcome, John, and welcome to those who are watching from home or your device, wherever you are. If you're out walking, I know you can still watch on your device. or maybe driving. We'll hope you're not driving and watching, but welcome. The Apostle Paul, this seasoned servant of Christ, speaks to his young colleague and wants to remind Timothy of who God is. And here's what he says. Even if we believe not, if our end of the deal is all over the place, as it often is, if our faith wobbles, does your faith wobble? Even if we believe not, listen to this, he remains faithful. Isn't that good? Why? Because he can't deny himself. He would de-God himself if he wasn't faithful to his people or faithful to his promises. Isn't that good to know? I need to hear that this morning. I think maybe you do as well. And Paul also said this, faithful is he who called you. He will also do it. He'll keep his word. How amazing is that? And that's the New Testament. Many, many, many years before God proved himself to be faithful to his ancient people, didn't he? So much so that the psalmist said, ascribe greatness to our God, the rock. His work is perfect. His ways are just. A God of faithfulness, without injustice, good and upright is he. Elsewhere, all his works are faithful. And his faithfulness is a shield to those who fear him. I love that. And then, of course, these words. The steadfast love of the Lord never ceases. His mercies never come to an end. They are new every morning. Great is your faithfulness. Let's stand, for great is thy faithfulness.
Is thy faith.
You showed great restraint. You really did. I could have sang. You realize that? In grace, I want to join the music group because the music group can sing. And I could stand up here and give it the bifters, but I didn't want to make you jealous. Let's pray together. Father, we thank you so much. We thank you for who you are. In fact, we worship you for who you are. And we thank you for all of the blessings that you have showered, lavished upon us. We thank you for keeping your word to us. As your people, we look back, some of us, maybe a few months, a few years, some of us for many, many years, and you've kept every single promise. Thank you. There have been times that we have failed you. Often we have failed you. As we said a few moments ago, our end of the deal can be all over the place. We wibble and we wobble and we fall down. But we thank you that your end of the deal is signed, sealed, and settled. And it's all dependent on your character. You cannot deny yourself. You are our faithful God. And we try to keep our promises. Sometimes we are able to, sometimes we break our promises. And we've been let down countless times, but never, never been let down by you. Again, it's insufficient, O God, but we say thank you. Thank you. Thank you. We're needy people today, and we need to hear your word. We need you to speak to us. We, Lord, want your truth to impact us in the culture that we're living in, all of the uncertainties. Lord, we watch the news, and we could easily pull our hair out and become extremely anxious. Lord, we need your truth to penetrate our hearts. So come to us today by your Spirit, through your word, and minister to us. For those watching from home, we ask that you would bless them. We know that, Lord, this has been such a difficult 15, 16 months. But Lord, we thank you that your word isn't bound. Come to us, we pray this day. Thank you that this is the Lord's day. Thank you that we remember the risen, living Jesus, the one who rose from the grave. And we worship him and praise him and want to serve him and spread his gospel to the ends of the earth till he comes again in power and great glory. So to this end we pray, please, hear us. Accept the praise that we offer and the worship that we bring. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. We're going to have a Bible reading now. Paul's going to come and read to us from Matthew chapter 6. Thank you. Give us the verses, Paul, would you? Thank you.
Today's reading is from Matthew chapter 6, verses 5 to 15. And when you pray, you must not be like the hypocrite, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogue and at the street corner, that they may be seen by others. Truly, I say to you, they have received their reward. But when you pray, go into your room and shut the door and pray to your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you.
And when you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask him. Pray like this: Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name, your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also have forgiven our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your Father forgive your trespasses. Amen.
Thank you, Paul. I guess it must have been 5-6 years ago. Went down to London, and we went to Buckingham Palace. Anybody been to Buckingham Palace? Yeah? Well, Alison wanted to go and see the Queen's dresses. I didn't want to see the Queen's dresses, but anyway, she did. And anyway, I wanted a little bit of a nosy around the palace. I did fancy that. And in Buckingham Palace, there are 775 rooms. Can you believe that? Yeah? Bedrooms and bathrooms and ballrooms and dining rooms and stately rooms and sitting rooms, waiting rooms and music rooms, and on it goes. And the throne room. We went into the throne room. There was a sense of awe even as we went into the throne room. Unfortunately, the Queen wasn't there at the time. But how blessed we are as the King's kids to be able to walk straight into the throne room of His Royal Highness, King Jehovah, and He accepts us. We can run in any time of the day or night and tell Him anything and everything. The writer to the Hebrews tells his readers about this access that we have with boldness into the throne room. They were converted Jews, so they knew all about the Old Testament high priest and how that the high priest was only allowed to go into the Holy of Holies once a year on the Day of Atonement. In fact, they tied a rope to his waist just in case when he went into the presence of God, he was struck down. And no one could go in to get him out, so they would pull him out with his rope. And around the hem of his long flowing garment, he had bells. And they would listen from outside. He would go in, hold their breath. And then when they heard the bells, ding-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling-a-ling, he'd survive for another year. And their sin had been covered. So they knew all of that. And when the writer to the Hebrews tells them, now, in Christ we have something better. No fear of condemnation. We can go with boldness, with confidence, into the throne room and make our petitions to Him. Why? Because His throne is a throne of grace. Isn't that good? Let's stand again as we listen to this. Boldly I approach the throne.
Somehow I stand where before the throne of God above. He pulls me close with nail-scarred hands into his everlasting arms. When condemnation grips my heart and Satan tempts me to despair, I hear the voice that scatters fear. The great I am, the Lord is here. Oh, praise the one who fights for me and shields my soul eternally.
Please open your Bible again, if you would, at Matthew chapter 6, verses 5 to 15. I want to talk to you today about prayer. Most sermons on prayer go like this. Do you pray? How often do you pray? How long do you pray? How much do you pray? How much more do you need to pray? And we're all left feeling terribly ashamed and very guilty. What's the point of that? Actually, it's counterproductive. We shy away from prayer. We feel it's an impossible bar to reach. Well, as we look at this passage today, hopefully we'll see and sense the amazing privilege of prayer. and that will be helpful to us. Wood. One. But the great privilege of coming to our Father and pouring our hearts out to Him. Not whipped, but wooed. I need wooed, don't you? Don't forget that this is part of the Sermon on the Mount, one of the most famous sermons, speeches, discourses ever given. Even people who don't read the Bible or know the Bible quote from the Sermon on the Mount. And that shouldn't be a surprise because the teaching of Jesus is so powerful and so profound, isn't it? And remember, if you would, the overall context of Matthew's Gospel. Matthew paints Jesus in regal colors, in royal colors. He's the king in Matthew's gospel. So, for example, in chapter 1, his family tree is traced all the way back to who? To David, King David. He's the rightful heir to David's throne. So from the get-go, chapter 1, he's the king. Chapter 2, his birth is feared by an earthly king, King Herod. Why? Because he sees Jesus as a rival, as a threat. He's the king, not him. But the end of chapter 2, Eastern kings come from afar with their gifts of gold, frankincense, and myrrh. They present their gifts to the Christ child and they bow before him in homage, acknowledging, yes, they're kings, but he is the King of Kings and Lord of Lords. So the first two chapters of Matthew, Jesus pretty clearly is the king. In chapter 3, a royal herald goes before him. His name? John the Baptist, according to Jesus, the greatest man to be born of a woman. Imagine that, the greatest man to be born of a woman being the herald. How great must the king be? Yeah? If that's how great the herald is. And John the Baptist's message is this: the kingdom, there it is, the kingdom is at hand. And with the kingdom comes the king. And then in chapter 4, Jesus begins his ministry. He goes to Galilee, he goes to every synagogue, and he preaches. What does he preach? The gospel of the kingdom. So Matthew paints Jesus in regal, royal colors. The whole way through his gospel, just giving you a little taste or a little flavor. Get your concordance out and chase it through yourself later on. Here in Matthew chapter 5, chapter 6, chapter 7, we have the king's speech, the Sermon on the Mount. And he tells us what it looks like to follow him. What it looks like to follow the king, what it looks like to belong to the kingdom. Of course, he begins with the beautiful attitudes. Here in this section that we're looking at today, he talks about prayer and praying. Of course, the scribes and Pharisees, the religious bods of the day, were well off beam. They'd lost the plot when it came to prayer. So before Jesus tells us how to pray, he has to tell us how not to pray. Okay. First of all, he speaks about performance praying. And we'll talk about that just for a few seconds, okay? Performance praying. Look at verse 5. When you pray, you must not be like the hypocrites, For they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and at the street corners that they may be seen by others. Truly, I say to you, they have their reward. See that? If you just look at the immediate context, the first little section of this chapter, verses 1 to 4, Jesus is speaking about performance giving. Later on, verse 16, performance fasting. So we have a little trilogy here. Giving, fasting, in the middle, the meat in the middle of the sandwich, performance praying. Our English word hypocrite that's used here in Greek is the same word for actor. It can be translated either way. Hypocrite or actor. The idea is performing for the crowd. That's the idea. Playing to the gallery. Looking for the applause of the audience. And of course, the Pharisees were expert at that. According to Jesus, they went to a place of prominence where everyone could see and hear and admire them. They wanted to create an impression. That was the driving force behind all that they did. If you've been to Israel, maybe you've gone to the Wailing Wall, the Western Wall, and if you're a man, you can go into the men's section. If you're a lady, you've got to go to the ladies' section. But either way, you'll be able to see, even from a distance, religious Jews up at the wall, writing out little prayers, sticking them in the cracks of the wall, and praying like this here. And then they go like this here. But as they go like this here, they're looking to see who's watching them. And if anybody's watching them, they go crazy. They really go for it. Yeah? It's the same today as it was back then. Wanting to be seen. Wanting people to think highly of them. They are so religious. Wow. They are the untouchables. And we can easily and quickly fall into the same trap, can't we? We need to be honest. It's a huge temptation for us to play to the gallery, to want the praise of people. But also in Bible times, Greek actors wore masks, not these kind of masks, okay, but a mask that covered their whole face to hide their true identity. So Jesus here puts his finger on this kind of hypocrisy, mask wearing, hiding behind the mask and performing, playing to the choir, playing to the gallery, showboat praying. It's illustrated, I think, in Luke's gospel. You remember the Pharisee there? He goes into the temple, head held high. Thank you, God. Thank you. I'm not like other men. I'm better. I'm holier. I'm godlier. Oh, what a good boy am I. Yeah? And he spots the tax collector with his head bowed, pleading for mercy. P.S. God, I thank you, I'm not like him over there. Performance praying, comparing and contrasting himself with others. And he was always going to come out on top. And you know what Jesus said about the Pharisee? He prayed with himself. He thought he was praying to God, but God says, no can do. You got the hand? Yeah. Talk to the hand. He prayed with himself. God wasn't listening. God wasn't interested in that kind of praying. And such praying, according to Jesus, might gain and get the praise of people. And if so, that's your reward. They've given you your reward. But look for a different reward. Verse 6. When you pray, go into your room, shut the door, pray to your Father who is in secret, and your Father who sees in secret will reward you. Now, again, just let me give you some background. We think open plan living is a fairly modern thing. It's not. Back in Bible days, houses were open plan. And there was nowhere to go to get any kind of privacy apart from the closet. And some versions call it a closet, a hidey hole, a little secret room, a little secret den out of the way. So it's just between God and you, and you and God. You say, hold on a minute. What about prayer meetings? What about praying in a smaller group? That's vitally important. It really is. But don't preach a sermon. I think that's how we can apply it to a prayer meeting or praying with friends. Don't preach a sermon. Don't show how much theology you know. Don't make points in your prayers. Don't pass on the latest gossip. We can do that, can't we? What's the news? So we can pray for you. And we're just gossip gathering. But particularly, what's driving, what's motivating our prayer? Are we looking for and longing for human reward? Or His reward? It's a warning, isn't it? I think an apt warning. Performance praying. How not to pray. And then secondly, pagan praying. Again, how not to pray. Look at verses 7 and 8. When you pray, do not heap up empty phrases as the Gentiles do or the pagans do, for they think that they will be heard for their many words. Do not be like them, for your Father knows what you need before you ask Him. And I guess the idea here is, you know, coming to God and twisting His arm, bending His ear, forcing His hand, manipulation praying, louder, longer. The more faith you have, the more promises you claim, eventually God will do whatever you want Him to do. A bit like a genie in the sky answering your every whim and fancy. Get God in an arm lock. And hold on. I mean, who do we think we are? Yeah? That's pagan praying, disguised as Christian praying. And sadly, much Christian praying is repackaged pagan praying. And using vain repetition over and over and over and over again and again and again and again, going on and on. You get the point. Yeah. Remember when your children were young, maybe coming into the kitchen. Can I get a biscuit? Can I get a biscuit? Can I get a biscuit? I've heard you the first time, yeah? You don't need to ask a million times. God doesn't say, thank you for telling me. I didn't have an idea about that. Thank you for cluing me in. No, He knows, says Jesus. You don't need to manipulate Him. He's more willing to answer than we are to ask. Praise God. So how not to pray, really? Performance praying, don't be like the hypocrites. And pagan praying, don't be like the Gentiles. Mantra praying. Number three, proper praying. How to pray. Verse 9, pray then like this. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. The basis of all proper prayer is our relationship with the Father. Our child-father relationship. This is mind-blowing. We don't really get it. But for a Jew back then, this was absolutely mind-blowing. For centuries, every Jew knew God as Elohim, the great creator God, or El Shaddai, the mighty God, or Jehovah, the covenant God. But now, Jesus speaks of God and to God as Father, Papa, Dad. A term of endearment, a term of intimacy, relationship, closeness. And in the Gospels, God has spoken of his Father 187 times. And from then on, all true believers come before him and do the very same. And we can speak to him anytime, anywhere, any place, about anything, and we're always welcome, and he'll always listen. He's always there. Now, I realize pastorally, sometimes this is a bit of a blockage for people. They have a difficulty with their father, if not worse. And they transfer that to God. And they can't picture God as Father. Bad connotations. Please. Please don't compare God to your father. Even if you had a good father, there's no comparison. Maybe your father, maybe your dad was distant. He wasn't a communicator. Maybe you feared your father. I don't know. God isn't distant. He has come to us in his Son. He's a great communicator. And he listens well. Yes, he's in heaven. He's a great and glorious king. But he's also Dad who delights to hear us. And notice it's not my father or your father, it's our Father. This is a family prayer. We're in this together. We're brothers and sisters in Christ. Jesus is our big brother. And we're heirs of the Father. And he tells us to come. He invites us to come on the basis of this relationship bought and wrought for us by the Son of Righteousness. And quickly, notice primarily prayer is worship. Again, verse 9, hallowed be your name. Maybe you learned the Lord's Prayer at school and you just repeated it parrot fashion. Did you ever think what the word hallowed meant? It means praised be your name. God's name is who he is. If you trace God's name right through the Bible, particularly in the Old Testament, when God introduced himself and told his servants his name, it was in the context of his character. This is who I am. So we worship God for who he is. We thank him for what he has done, but we praise him for who he is. I think that's an important distinction. And when, from our viewpoint, the blessings dry up, they don't dry up, but from our viewpoint, they dry up, he still is who he is, and he's worthy of our worship. Sometimes when we don't feel like thanking him. Yeah? So we thank him for what he does, but we worship him for who he is. So his name and his fame, your kingdom come. We're praying for his rule and his reign, for his kingdom, his salvation to come to our family and friends and neighbors and those around us. This is gospel praying, that the lost might be found, that sinners might be saved. Your kingdom come, your rule, your reign, your salvation. But it's more than that. It's the kingdom to come in all its fullness when the King returns in power and glory. Even so, come, Lord Jesus. So are your prayers gospel prayers? And are your prayers future prayers? We look around, don't we, and we wonder, where's it all going to end? Can I tell you where it's going to end? The king's coming back, and Jesus shall reign where'er the sun. And the trees of the field will clap their hands, and the lion will lie down with the lamb. And the glory of the Lord will cover the earth as the waters cover the sea. And we will reign with him. We've read the last chapter. That's how it ends. And we pray to that end, don't we? Your kingdom come. Your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Not wanting what we want, but what he wants. Resigning from the Trinity as of now. Realizing who we are and who he is. And praying accordingly. Your will be done. You know what is best. You know what is wise. You know the end from the beginning. I see this. You see this? Humble praying. And then give us this day our daily bread. It's a huge jump, isn't it, from hallowed be your name, your kingdom come, your will be done, and now we're praying for a bit of bread. It is a huge jump. But this great God is interested in the needs that we have as well. How good is that? We depend on him for absolutely everything, right down to a bit of bread. Everyday concerns, everyday cares. The simple, bare necessities. I'll not sing it to you. And our need not only for provision, but for pardon, for give us our debts as we forgive those who are indebted to us. See that, verse 12? I guess today we don't really understand forgiveness too much, but we do understand being in debt, don't we? You know, whenever we think about adverts and television about sinning, it's mainly to do with, you know, chocolate, isn't it? That's the connotations of sin today. And so I think it is helpful. The Bible speaks about debt because lots of people are in debt, max out their credit cards, all the loan sharks, yeah? And we're in debt to God. All of us. I'm in debt, you're in debt. And that's a problem, because if I'm in debt and you're in debt, I can't help you and you can't help me. We need someone who's in credit. That's where Jesus comes in. He's completely in credit. And he suffers and dies that we might have the sin debt cancelled. And when we pray, according to Jesus, we must come with that awareness. We are sinners, we're in debt, and we need forgiven. We owe all to him. And protection, verse 13, lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. Yes, retrospective praying, confession praying, but how about some preemptive praying? Some protection praying. You remember the disciples? Jesus encouraged his disciples to do that. Watch and pray, lest you enter into temptation. And they didn't. And they did. And sometimes, as believers, you know, we have this kind of woe is me attitude. It's right to pray penitent prayers. It's right to confess our sin, absolutely. But sometimes we're a bit like Captain Mannering in Dad's army. We're doomed. Remember, we're all doomed. We're not doomed. The power and the dominion of sin has been broken. Jesus has come to save us from our sin. We have the Holy Spirit, and his job, as his name suggests, is to make us holy. And we do fall, we do stumble. But that no longer defines us. That's not to be the pattern. That pattern has been broken. There should be victory. There should be progress in the Christian life. We want to win the fight, don't we? And we are to expect that and pray for that, for deliverance. Deliver us from evil. So there we have it. Performance, praying. Guard against praying to impress. We need to guard against that. I need to guard against that. I do lots of public praying, as you can imagine. I need to guard against that. I'm not praying to you. You can listen in if you want, but I'm not praying to you. I'm not trying to impress you. Sometimes I do, though. And so do you. Performance praying. And pagan praying, trying to manipulate God in some way. Again, another trap we fall into. And proper praying. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive those who are indebted to us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. It's not about length. It's not about clever terminology. It's not about sophisticated phrases. Pray simply, pray sincerely, knowing your Father, your King, hears you. And be thankful for the fact that Jesus gave his life and opened up a way for us that we might come to him without fear, without dread. The one who taught us to pray like this will soon go to the cross to open up that way. What an amazing privilege. And we're invited. We're invited to enjoy the amazing privilege of prayer. Let's pray. not let's pray. Let's pray. Let's pray. Not because we have to, but because we can. We have the ear of God. Now let's pray. Father, we fall short. We neglect the place of prayer. Please forgive us. Humble our hearts. May we catch afresh today how awesome this privilege is. We want to live in the atmosphere of prayer. We want to pray without ceasing. There are times that we need to give ourselves to prayer and fasting and holding on to you in extreme times. But Lord, we ask, please, as your people, that prayer would be our vital breath. The Christian life, O God, is impossible without staying in touch with headquarters. Like a soldier on the battlefield, on their lonesome. Oh, please, use this passage and our explanation of it, inept though it is, just to challenge us, to change us, we pray, please. We thank you for Jesus. We thank you, not only he taught us how to pray, we thank you that he opened up the way for us to pray. This privilege purchased for us by his blood. Overwhelm as we ask today with this amazing, amazing privilege. Please. For we ask this in Jesus' name. Amen. Joseph Scriven was born in Banbridge, Northern Ireland. And he endured great heartache, and to get over his heartache, he moved to Canada. But there, again, he suffered great heartache and heartbreak. His mother was elderly, back home in Northern Ireland. He wasn't able to travel home to see her. Instead, he wrote these words to encourage her. What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Can we stand as we listen to this?
In Jesus, all our sins and griefs to bear, and what a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Pain we bear, all because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. And temptations, is there trouble anywhere? For we should never be discouraged. Come on and take it to cleanse the spice, forsake thee. Take it to the Lord in prayer. For in his arms he'll take and shield thee, and thou wilt find the solace there. Oh, 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 sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer.
Thank you. Please be seated and let's pray again, can we? Father, these are basic things. We look back to when someone led us to Christ and the advice they gave us when we rose from our knees was read your Bible every day and pray. Read your Bible, pray every day and you'll grow, grow, grow. And yet, Lord, sometimes we move on from that and we think we can sort it ourselves, become self-reliant. Lord, we need to go back to basics. We need to relearn these lessons. We all do. Teach us to pray. Thank you that you're gracious. Thank you you're not the demon head master. Thank you that you're longing for us to talk to you. And we ask, please, that you would, as we prayed at the start, woo us. Win our hearts. It's a heart issue, oh God. We can make promises in the moment. That we can try to change. But Lord, it is a heart issue. Win our hearts, we pray. Cultivate within us, oh God, by your Spirit, this love, this longing to talk to Dad and avail ourselves of the privilege. Please, for we ask this in Jesus' name.